Today we're talking about hope. And let me tell you something. Hope, according to the world's definition of it, can be a very disappointing thing. And you know why that is? Because if you're hoping for something, meaning you're wishing that something really good would happen, then when it doesn't happen and you're disappointed, well, that really stinks, doesn't it? Now, on a lighter note, we all experience that, and I can give you some silly examples of some folks who were hoping for something really good, but it didn't turn out that way. There's this gal that went skiing for the very first time. She hit the slopes saying that she had high hopes for experience, but then things started to go downhill real fast. At least you got it. Okay. You got it at least, yeah. Or how about the guy that took the shell off of his pet snail? See, he was hoping that his little snail would become lighter and faster, but instead, he ended up sluggish. Or how about this one? Did you hear about the kid that was hoping his mom would never, ever, ever again serve those little German sausages for supper? He said the one that he ate was worst. Now, what about me? I was really hoping that you folks would just be laughing out of your seats, but I'm hearing so many groans that I'm just disappointed. Nobody appreciates my corny jokes, you see. That's why I was hoping for something, but I didn't get what I was hoping for. That's what the world's definition of hope is all about. You're really hoping it comes true, but then when it doesn't, oh, jeez. That's the problem with that kind of hope, when it's only a wish or a desire, and then you don't get what you want. But I'm going to tell you today about a different kind of hope, and that's biblical hope. This is the hope that exists that does not disappoint. No, it's not simply a wish. It's not a desire. It's not a, gee, I hope that happens, but I doubt it will kind of situation. It is a hope that is different because it really, really, really is good, and it really is gonna happen. There's not gonna be a disappointment. That's the kind of hope that we're gonna look at today. It's a hope that's guaranteed by Almighty God. And the key to experiencing this hope, which is future coming, is again to wait for it. Wait upon the Lord. Today, we need to recognize that we need to wait upon the Lord with hope. So let's get right into it now. Again, with all these Advent messages, we're going to be looking generally at three main passages, so we won't be digging deeply into them. It'll be more devotional. Sorry about that for those of you that like real technical Bible study. But these passages, they will be a help to us to understand all about waiting upon the Lord. In particular, speaking of hope, let's look at this biblical kind of hope. The first passage that we have today is Romans chapter 8, verses 22 to 25. If you want to find that passage, now would be a good time, and I'll let you know as you're finding it, that prior to verse 22, Paul is talking about how this world has been a mess for a real long time. Have you noticed that this place that we live in is very, very messy? It's a big fat mess. That's what Paul is talking about. And in lieu of that, here's what he says in verse 22. He says, "For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved." Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. You see, the creation has been messed up for a very long time. And as such, the creation itself, figuratively speaking, is looking forward to the future when things are restored. And it's not a mess anymore. Paul even uses the illustration of a mother-to-be that's about to have a baby. That's what the creation is like. Can't wait until things get better. When my sister was carrying her first child, and she was near the end of her pregnancy, she was doing all that she could because she was very eager to get my little nephew out. In fact, at one point, she was even going out into her flower beds and jumping up and down, shaking and getting weeds out and stuff because she was hoping that she'd shake the little guy out. Can't wait for him to be born. Can't wait for this to move on. That's what it's like in the creation in which we live now. Something better's got to happen. Bring it on, baby. That's what we're talking about here. In verse 23, we read that we as believers are in the same case. We're looking forward to the future because when that future comes, we will be fully adopted as Christians, as the children of God. Now, some of you that are pretty solid Bible scholars might be saying, time out. What do you mean our future adoption? I thought I was already adopted as a child of God. Well, yes, you were. Ephesians 1 makes it very clear that we are adopted. And yet we're going to be adopted. How does that work? Well, initially when you are saved, you are adopted as a child of God, meaning you are justified, brought into the kingdom. Now, as we live this life as Christians, we continue to be saved or be adopted. That's called sanctification. We're moving towards something. We're growing. That's sanctification. And then ultimately, in the future, we will ultimately be saved. We will finally be adopted, realizing it fully. That's called glorification. And that's what Paul is talking about here. We're looking forward to that full and final adoption when the process is over and we're glorified in heaven. Verses 24 to 25, we look forward to and we hope for that day. If it was already here and we were fully saved, we were fully glorified, we wouldn't need to hope, but we're in a state now where we hope, and we hope in a way in which we're looking forward to it coming, because it is coming. So the point for us as Christians is this. We don't want to be here anymore someday. We want to fully be adopted. And we hope, not as a pie in the sky, gee, I wish it would happen. No, no, no. We look forward to it because it's guaranteed to come for us as believers. That's fantastic news. That's the kind of hope that this is talking about. That's what we're talking about today. Now, you might be here thinking, well, that's good, but what is the connection to Advent or to Christmas? What's this all about? Well, let's look at the biblical hope and the Christmas connection. This time, we'll be looking at John chapter 1, verses 1 to 15. Of the three passages, this is probably the most difficult of the three. So in lieu of that, we're going to read it verse by verse and try to figure out what John is saying to us here. John chapter 1, verses 1 to 15, and we invite you to follow along or listen as well. Let's look at verse 1. John 1:1 starts, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Now, if that doesn't make sense to you, what's this all about, the Word was, the Word, God? No, I don't understand that. Well, to do a little trick to help you out, just for a moment, and this isn't totally correct, but change the word Word, W-O-R-D, with Jesus, J-E-S-U-S. Does that make more sense? In the beginning was Jesus. Jesus was with God, and Jesus was God. So what we're talking about is Jesus, as he came into the world, the person of God comes to us in the person of Jesus, not only then, but even far back in eternity past, Jesus, or God, the pre-incarnate Jesus, theologians would say, always the Word, always the Word, always God. Now why do we use the word Word? Why does John use that word Word if he's referring to Jesus there? Well, I've shared this with you pretty much every year during Advent. This little chart comes up again and again. If you don't remember it, good, we'll learn it all over again. The word Word, biblically speaking, and in other ways, means the following. In the Bible, the word Word referred to an agent of creation, someone who's able to make something or create something. The word Word also refers to God's message from Ezekiel 34, and also God's law. So when you hear the word Word in this verse, you should be thinking of, okay, whoever we're talking about the Creator, the message from God, God's law. And not only that, but beyond the biblical text to the Greek culture, the word referred to the principle of reason which governs the world. And I think that's how a lot of people who are reading this Greek New Testament would have understood that. In other words, the word is almost like, may the force be with you, in their minds. I think that would have been a better way to write the movie, in my opinion, but never mind. That's what we're talking about here. So rather than referring to Jesus as him, or that guy, or that fellow, John describes him as he truly is, the Word, the Creator, the one who brought the message from God, God's law, that which governs the entire universe. It's kind of like the same reason that people shouldn't, and I shouldn't even repeat this, but I'm going to, people really shouldn't refer to Queen Elizabeth as that old lady. Don't do that. What's her title? Her Majesty. Yes, isn't that much better? That's a better description. Same thing here. The Word, when we're talking about Jesus, he's not just any old fella. He's the Word. Verse 2 says, he was in the beginning with God. One commentator put it this way. This verse underscores that the Word coexisted with the Father from the beginning. Make sure that we understand that the Word is eternal. He's eternal. He didn't just come along as some Johnny come lately. Verse 3, all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Well, there you go. What's number one on there for what the Word is? Letter A, agent of creation. Everything was created through the Word, because the Word was co-creator with the Father. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 16 reminds us, for by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. He's creator. Now, here's where this really gets personal for us. In him, verse 4, was life, and the life was the light of men. What does that mean? Well, throughout John's gospel, we see that life refers to the divine, eternal life, not just a normal life. And this divine, eternal life brings about light. I better be careful here. I'm saying life and light, they sound similar, but they're two different things. The life of God brings about light. What does that mean? Well, light, we're talking about divine truth, exposure of sin, moral insight, spiritual vision, shining a light on it. That's what the life, who is the Word, what he does for us. He changes us. He shines light into the world and shines light to us. That's going to be very important as we see what this means. Verse 5 then says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. So Jesus comes into the world, he brings life, he brings light, and no matter how dark this world is, you can't shut him off. There have been many people down through the ages that have tried to stop the message of Jesus Christ. There are many people that would love to see this church and every other church just go bye-bye. Well, let me tell you something, that's not going to happen. And the reason is because the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not overcome it. It's a great illustration. If you make a room very, very dark, go home today, pull down the shades, close the curtains, take and tape up every little crack with duct tape. Actually, don't do that. You'll make a mess. Use masking tape, whatever. Tape it shut so it's so dark in there that you can't even see your hand in front of your face. And then you have somebody else in there that turns on the teeniest little light. Are you going to be able to see it? You bet you will, because the darkness cannot overcome the light. The light just pierces right through it. So this light that came into the world, for us, nothing's going to stop it. nothing will. Now, let's take a little sidetrack here in verses 6, 7, and 8. John seems to be taking a sidetrack that the ancient people needed. Maybe we do as well. He says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. Not this John. He's talking about John the Baptist. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. This might not be a struggle for us, but some people in this time maybe thought that John the Baptist was the Word, the life, the light. Nope, it's not him. It's somebody else. Some other light, the true light. Well, who is the true light? Verse 9. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. Verse 10. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. See, John the Baptist, an ordinary dude, wasn't the light. The Word was the light. And this light, if you will, that gives light to the world, well, it goes out into the whole world. Theologians discuss what that means, but just suffice it to say, the light of Jesus continues to shine, folks. It always has. It always will. It's going to keep on shining. And even though it keeps on shining, the world doesn't recognize it. How can that be? The answer is because they don't want to recognize it. Even verse 11, his own people, he came to his own people did not receive him. That's referring to the majority of the Jewish nation, the Jewish people. Still to this day, many of them, most of them, do not believe Jesus is the Messiah, his own people. But it's not all bad news. 12 and 13. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God, who were born not of blood, not of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but God. Some did. Some still do receive him. Many, many here today, of course, as we know. And those that do, when you receive the light, you become a child of God. Not by natural means, not because a mom and a dad decided so, no, 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 an earthly mom or dad, that is, but rather totally by a miracle of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. And then verses 14 and 15, this passage is sort of like a shotgun passage, all these thoughts. It summarizes it all up here where it says, the Word became flesh, dwell among us. We have seen his glory. Glory is the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks before me because he was before me. So to put it all together, the Word becomes flesh. That brings life. That brings light into the world. The light shines forth. Many people don't want to see it, but those that get it, those that receive the light, life is different now. You get a new life. You become a new creature. And if it matters to you, John says, I can testify to this. The other John, John the Baptist, can testify to it. It is true. Now, that's the story there in its plain meaning. And you might be saying, you still didn't tell us what the Christmas connection is. The answer is, this is the Christmas story. God coming to us in the person of Jesus. And if you think about it, if you're here today and you have the light of God in your heart, if you have a new life because of him, if this never would have happened, if the Word would have never, ever, ever become flesh, then we would be in a big, fat mess. There would be no hope. Can you imagine if we were walking around thinking, oh my goodness, this world, this is it? This messed up world, this is all we get? This is my life. This is my existence. You know what? That would really, really, really stink, wouldn't it? And I'm going to say something that would stink even more than that. Even though we would be believing it, what? This is it? This wouldn't be it. Because the fact is, if Christ had not come, the entire human race, after living this life thinking this is it and it really stinks, the entire human race, whether you want to hear it or not, would be headed for a terrible place called hell. That's really depressing. But even though it's depressing, it's not the case. Because the light did come. The Word did become flesh. Because of Christmas, because of the Word coming into the world, because of the light and the life and all of that, we have hope. This life isn't it. There is better days coming. There are better days in eternity and our full and final adoption as the children of God. It's going to get better, folks. That's what the hope is all about. Now, let's talk about how we respond to this. How shall we live our life in lieu of all of this? Well, I think the answer is we wait upon the Lord with hope. My life as a Christian and your life should be such that it's almost like even on a really, really bad day, we can still be on the edge of our seat hopeful because of what's coming next. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 40, verses 27 to 31 for a moment. In this passage, we're going to find out how the people of God were told to wait upon the Lord, wait for his time, and do it with hope. While you're turning there, we'll tell you that the immediate context of this particular prophecy is Isaiah speaking to the southern kingdom of Judah. He's warning them, you folks, you messed up, you disobeyed, and what God is going to do, he's going to have your enemies come in here and take you exile. You're going to be captive. You're going to be prisoners in a faraway place called Babylon. But here's some hope now in chapter 40. It's going to end. There's going to be a restoration. The enemies are going to be defeated and things are going to get good again. So isn't that something? God tells them, even before he punishes them, yeah, the punishment's coming, but don't worry because after I punish you, things are going to be great. That's the immediate context. But see, this prophecy, like many prophecies, also has another application. Prophecy has its immediate application, and it also points to other things and other events. This prophecy also points to God coming to us in the person of Jesus Christ. So what can we learn from this? Well, in verse 27, let's read the passage. Isaiah 40, beginning in verse 27, the whole thing. It says, "Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not grow faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." Apparently, as one writer said, there were some practical atheists there in Jerusalem and Judea, or in Judah, excuse me, in verse 27. The people were walking around and they were saying, my way is hidden from the Lord. In fact, he prophesies here that whenever they get to Babylon, this is the way they're going to be thinking. My way is hidden. God's disregarded me. He's given up on me. He doesn't care. Verse 28, time out. Don't you know? Haven't you heard? God is eternal. He knows everything that's going on, and he doesn't wear out, and he doesn't give up. In fact, verse 29, he's the one who gives power to those who are faint and weak. And by the way, verse 30, everybody faints, everybody gets weak, everybody gets worn out. Even young people who are supposed to be full of vim and vigor, they wear out too. But I'll tell you what, verse 31, they who wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They're going to be ones that mount up with wings like eagles, fly like eagles. They're going to run and not run out of steam. He's addressing those who wait upon the Lord with hope. Yeah, you get worn out. Yeah, you get tired. But if you wait upon the Lord with hope, if you know and you believe in your heart, because as you are as a new believer, as a new child of God in Jesus Christ, as a new creature, I'm trying to say, and you know that something better is coming, and you wait in the edge of your seat for that, let me tell you something. You're going to be strong, and you're going to be able to run. That's what this is all about. You see, there's two ways that you can live your life and look towards the future. You can wait upon the Lord with biblical hope, like we're talking about here, and biblical hope, waiting for the Lord with biblical hope. Do you know what that's like? Well, 1 Thessalonians 5:8 says this about hope. It compares it to a piece of armor. It says, but since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and get this, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. Both here, Ephesians 6 refers to this helmet of salvation. What does that mean? Well, first of all, what does a helmet do? Well, it protects your head, right? And it protects your head. And what is it that protects your head? The hope of salvation. What's the connection? Basically, if you wait on the edge of your seat and you have that hope and you know that God is going to come through for you and one day you're going to be in his presence as his child, as his son or his daughter, well, for crying out loud, that keeps you from going crazy. It protects your head like a helmet. I don't know about you, but I want that helmet on my head every day of my life. I think I'm crazy enough, and I'd be really crazy if I didn't have that. How about you? But speaking about craziness, the other way to live your life is to struggle through life with no hope. Because you know what the Bible says about that? Proverbs 13:12 says that hope deferred makes the heart sick. What's it like to live this life again thinking that this is it, this is all I get, and I don't think there's anything coming next, and if there is, it's probably nothing good. Actually, a non-believer, that's true. Unfortunately, what's it like to live your life like that? It's sickening. It's depressing. It's awful. So which way do you want to live your life? You want to live with biblical hope? Or you want to live with a sick heart all the days of your life here in this world? I'm telling you, we need to grab this message for all that it's worth. If you're a believer in Jesus, don't forget, you're a new creature. You are the son or the daughter of God. And someday in the great beyond, in that place when we're in the presence of the Lord, you'll really fully realize your sonship, your daughtership, that you are a child of God. Wait for that. Appreciate it. Look forward to it. Keep on the edge of your seat every day of your life, knowing that it's coming, because it is coming. We as believers have one choice and one choice only. We wait upon the Lord with hope. Thank God for Advent. Thank God for Christmas Day. Thank God for the Word who became flesh. Because of Him, we can wait upon the Lord with hope.